My name is Memo Rungui, and this session is about pay structuring. So I'm going to take you through a simple way to understand pay structuring. Remember, this is an introduction of pay structuring. It's not going to be a technical presentation. The next stage would be that we can go through a technical presentation on pay structuring once you have understood the basics of pay structuring. At the end, you can ask me questions, very open to questions at the end as we go. But if you've got a burning question as I go through this presentation, you can also ask me the questions as we are going through the presentation. That is perfectly fine. So the whole concept of pay structuring is new to others, but I'll try to simplify it so that all of you can understand what pay structuring is. Let's start with maybe a few definitions of what pay structuring is all about. So some of you may have what they're calling a pay structure, and you want to see if that is a proper pay structure. So a pay structure, in very simple terms, is a series of job grades showing the minimum, the midpoint, and the maximum of a pay grade. So it's a series of grades or a list of grades showing the minimum salary, the midpoint, and the maximum salary for each grade. The reason why pay structuring is important is that it then allows you to reward people who have got jobs of similar value equitably. For example, if people are in the same grade, you don't expect them to have huge variations. The variations will be there because each pay grade has got a range, but they must not be huge to such an extent that they create elements of inequity within the organization. Okay, so that is important for you to take note. Why do we have pay structuring in an organization? The reason is for you to be able to reward people, jobs of equal value to the organization equitably. One of the key things that I normally find people asking me is that you'll find in most pay structures, there is what is called pay overlap. It's perfectly normal. There is a reason for having those pay overlaps. Any credible pay structure will have overlaps because a person in a lower grade can earn more than a person in a higher grade, provided that person is a good performer. You can have a poor performer in a higher grade and they don't necessarily deserve to get a higher pay whilst they're in there. So that is important for you to take note of. So let's look at a typical pay structure. I want to give you a few minutes to look at this. This is a typical pay structure. If your organization does not have something like this, I don't know what it's called. Because a pay structure, a normal pay structure is like this. As you can see, you'll have your grades at the beginning there, then your minimum salary, your midpoint, your maximum, and what is called the pay range and the pay progression, and I'll explain all these in detail. So when you look at the pay structure, the most important part of a pay structure is this component called the midpoint. This midpoint of a pay structure reflects your target market as an organization. For example, your organization may target to pay people at the 50th percentile, which is the median, or they may target to pay people at the 75th percentile, which is the upper quarter. So this is really a competitive position as an organization. Where are we targeting as an organization in terms of competitive position? So you can target to pay at any of those. I rarely see organizations that are targeting to pay around 25th percentile, which is the lower quarter, because it's not competitive. The way you choose your midpoint is very crucial in the sense that it then determines whether your pay structure is competitive or not. If you don't choose your midpoint properly, you'll get to a stage where you start losing people, even if you've got a pay structure. Remember, the pay structure, its purpose is to be able to pay people equitably and also to be able to attract and retain the right people within the organization. So that's typically a pay structure. So when you come here, you will also notice that there is what is called a pay range. This pay range is the percentage difference between the maximum and the minimum of that pay grade. That is the pay range. It's just showing how wide is the pay range. In other quarters, they call it range breadth. Okay, it's the breadth of the range. How wide is your range as you design your pay structure? Then your pay progression is also important to take note of. The pay progression is important for you to take note of. This pay progression is the percentage difference between the midpoints of adjacent grades, as you can see there. That's the percentage difference of the midpoints of the adjacent grades in your pay structure. So in this case, I've used the typical Castellion kind of system to come up with this particular pay structure. So that's the typical pay structure using the Castellion system. It can be any grade. It could be the A system. It could be the Patterson system. Any grading system, you will have to put your grades here as the first column. Then you have your minimum. You have your midpoint. Then your maximum and your range and your progression. Again, I want to emphasize the key component of any pay structure is actually the midpoint, which is called the pay spine. The midpoint is the control point for the pay spine or the target competitive market position for your organization. In some organizations, you find that they've got pay policies where they say, we are going to be paying at the 75% of the market. So that pay structure must always be reflecting that. And also what is important is once your pay structure has been developed to this stage, you must make sure that you're always updating so that you don't lag behind your target competitive market position. That target market competitive market position can change anytime depending on issues to do with affordability and many other economic factors and social factors that we'll talk about later on. So my key question is, I want you to put your message on the chat there. There's a way you can put your message. On the chat, I want to see, do you have a proper pay structure like this in your organization? Just put yes or no, just for intersect. Just put yes or no, so that I know how many people have got a typical pay structure. So a typical proper pay structure looks exactly like this. And we'll go through the process of developing one in simple terms. Today, I'm not going to really cover the really detailed technical stuff, but I'll take you through a simple calculation that we'll do at a later stage. So I want you to, under chat there, just put if you have got a pay structure that looks like this or not. And if you just put yes or no, I just want a yes or no. I don't want a lot of things there. Just put yes or no. Yes, I can see yes there. No, no. Let's continue. Let's go, everyone. I expect everyone to put a there's a response there. No, no. Okay, we can continue putting those in there as we go through this process. So that's a typical pay structure. So if you don't have this kind of thing in your organization, you need to start asking yourself, what do we have if it doesn't look like this? Because this is a typical pay structure. If your grades are not arranged like this in a pay structure, this is a typical pay structure. It could be that the person who developed the pay structure does not understand the mechanics of pay structuring or has no idea what pay structuring is, because it must look something like this, but not exactly in terms of the ranges and percentages. Those can vary. But I'm saying in terms of structure, it must have a grade, a minimum, a midpoint, a maximum. Then it must indicate how wide your ranges are, for example, here. Then your progression, the difference in percentage terms between adjacent grades, adjacent midpoints, of your grades. That's how you get that. So important to take note. So when you look at the salary range, most people struggle to then understand how do I make sure that I've got the right salary range. So a salary range is basically, like I explained, the difference between the midpoint, the maximum and the minimum of a pay grade. They normally range from 15 to as high as 180%. The higher the pay range, the more you find that the organization probably pays for performance or want to differentiate people based on performance, what is called broad banding sometimes, where you've got very wide bands in terms of salary ranges. Common salary ranges are, however, in the Zimbabwean environment, you normally find they're 40 to 80%. Others are slightly more. The others that are narrower, especially as you go into the civil service kind of situation, you find in parastatal sometimes, you find they've got lower pay range. The disadvantage with lower pay range is that you don't have scope to be able to differentiate people within the pay range because they're very narrow. And more so if you're going to do notching in those pay ranges, as I'll talk about later on. Then your progression, the standard progression can range from as little as 80% to as high as 60%, even as high as 80%. Whilst this is the normal kind of standard way of having these ranges, they also must vary depending on the type of skill that you have in the particular grades, But the moment you start doing that, you also start bringing inconsistencies. If you don't know how to differentiate your ranges by grade, for example, you normally tend to have higher wider ranges as you go up. If you don't know how to do that, it's better to have a standard range, for example, like the example that I showed you, 80% across all grades. Then the same applies to your progression. You use the same standard progression, for example, 30% across all grades. It's much better if you don't know. But if you know and you are more sophisticated mathematically, there are ways of differentiating the pay ranges depending on the skills that you have. For example, in the lower grades, you may want to have very narrow ranges. Well, the skills variety, skills depth and variety in those grades is very minimal. So you don't really want to differentiate people a lot. So let's look at this particular graph. I think I skipped another graph there. Looking for, I can't find the graph that I want. Okay, so after your job grading, this is what you normally find. So you've done your grading, and after the grading has been done, and you've aligned them to the pay structure and everything, and to the market, you will see that your grading is actually showing that the relationship between your grade and pay is about R squared of 0.95, which means grade alone is explaining 95% of the variation in salaries. That's normally what you want to get. Sometimes you can get around 70%, around 80%. It's just showing whether your grading is really working, because there must be a relationship between your grade and your basic salary. So that's normally what you get. But in some instances, what you tend to get is we do what is called an as-is analysis, where we just take the new grades and the salaries that are currently obtaining, and out of that, you can come up with a distribution. Sometimes what you get is you get a spider web, where there is actually no relationship between your grades and salaries. That, if you get to that stage, if you find yourself in such kind of a situation, you need to align and come up with something like this. And I'll show you later on how we do that. Okay, so here is another example that I'm showing here, because I want to take you to another stage of pay structure in terms of understanding the terms. So whilst you are here, the key thing is, I talked earlier on about making sure that your pay structure is current. The way to do that is, if you come here on this particular pay structure, you come at the bottom there. Every time your market has moved, let's say, for example, the market for on average across all grades, you say the market has moved by 22%. You come here, you put an equal sign there, and if you're in Excel, you adjust the bottom midpoint grade by 22%. It will automatically adjust all the grades upwards by the same percentage. That's the easiest way if you are doing it in Excel. Because if you don't do that and leave your pay structure to lag behind the market, this is where you then find that, for example, you are trying to recruit someone in grade 4 and they come. You can see there the minimum is 10,000, the midpoint is 14,000, the maximum is 18,000. You are trying to recruit someone in grade 4, you may find that person is demanding 25,000, which is already a salary for grade 3. That then creates problems. Do you want really to bring a stranger, a new person, and they start earning a salary outside your pay bands? It's not advisable. So what it could mean is that if you're constantly getting situations like that, it also means that your pay structure is lagging behind the market. So there are mechanisms to make sure that every time you do salary adjustment, you must then be able to adjust your pay structure to match the movement in the market. That is very crucial for us to understand. As you are administering your pay structure, there are other important aspects to take note here. Here is a typical organization. The names are fictitious. Everything here is fictitious. So the key terms that I want you to understand is what is called the compa ratio and the range penetration. They're very crucial there. So you can see there's a name, job title, grade, current salary, the grade, the minimum grade, the grade minimum, the grade midpoint, the grade maximum. I've just basically replicated the pay structure from above there. Then when you come here, you can see, if you look there at the compa ratio, the compa ratio is used in two different ways. Let me explain. It can be used in salary surveys, market salary survey. It can be used internally when you are doing your internal pay analysis. So what do you do with the compa ratio, and what is it? So the way to calculate a compa ratio is you take the person's salary, the individual salary, for example, this 11,452, you divide that salary by the midpoint. Remember, we said the midpoint is the pay spine. That's the most competitive position for that grade. So we are trying to compare whether the person is really competitive in relation to the to your pay structure, or the how far are they from the midpoint of your pay structure. That's very crucial for us to take note of that. So you calculate the compa ratio for each individual. You put it exactly as I have done there for all your staff. So you calculate your compa ratio. You can see there, the compa ratio range is from 80 to 120. That's the standard compa ratio range. So anything outside that, you need to start questioning. Why is it like that? How did it come to be? And what are the reasons? Are the reasons justifiable? Do we need to change, or we leave it like that? For example, you may find, for example, Eddie now is the sales executive in this particular case. The compa ratio is 67%. What it means is that this Edina is being paid below the minimum of the grade. Let's come here and see. It's very easy to see there. But if you are dealing with large numbers of people, it may not be as we are seeing now. But if you come to Edina, who is in grade 4, there's someone who is unmuted there. I will meet everyone. Okay, so if you look at Edina there, you see Edina is a sales executive. She is in grade 4. The minimum for that grade is 10,456. Edna is earning 9,875. In relation to the competitive position, which is the midpoint, remember your midpoint is the most competitive position of your pay range or a grade. And the target for when we do pay structuring is that we must move our most competent people towards the midpoint. So if you look at Edna, for example, she is only earning 67% of the midpoint. There are various reasons for that, but what you must never do, like in this case, Edna and Costa, the internal auditor, highlighted in yellow, they're all earning below the minimum. Once they've done your job evaluation, you've come up with the best structure, no one should be paid below the minimum. That is the standard. No one should be paid below the minimum. For whatever reason, no one should be paid below the minimum of that grade. So you adjust this place. So if I were you as the HR executive or manager, I'll then move Edna's salary to 10,456. I can also consider other factors if they have been there and they are performing. I may actually pay them 11, I may pay them 12, I may not actually pay them directly on the midpoint. But as long as their compa ratio comes into 80 to 120% range, that's enough. Then as you go down there, you'll also notice that Sharon, the machine operator, her compa ratio is 186%, which means she's actually earning more than the maximum of that particular grade. Okay, she's up 100%, more than 100%. Percent of the compa ratio, it's a problem. You also look at the cleaner Dama, there is earning at a compa ratio of 125%. So as you're administering your pay structure, if you've got someone, does not necessarily have to be done by the HR executive. It can be someone who is skilled in remuneration, who is a remuneration expert in your organization. To keep on flagging these things, these are the issues that bring inequity. There are the people who may be in the same grade and they will be wondering, how come Dama is earning, a cleaner is earning 785, which is 125% of the midpoint. So Dama is 5% above the standard compa ratio range. Okay, so that brings problem. If you remember what I said earlier on, I said when you are paying employees, always remember that your new employees must be paid close to the minimum. Your less experienced employees must be started the minimum. Employees who are coming from outside the organization, you are not sure how they're going to perform. You are not sure how they're going to fare in your organization. So you can't start by just paying them at the midpoint. You're taking a huge risk for the organization. They may turn up, let's take an example. If you're hiring someone in grade 5, the midpoint is 11.260. I would never pay them 11.260, no matter how skilled they are, because I don't know how they're going to perform. I have no record of how they perform. I've only done reference checks in the interview. They may come here, they may not fit into the organization, but I've already tied my organization into a high cost structure. What you do is to say to Marco, who is the engineer, Marco, our minimum for this grade is 8043. If they bargain and whatever, you can go to as far as 10 or 9, but be very careful. Because those bargaining powers, you are just basically coming up with an arbitrary figure in terms of a salary. So by all means, try to pay your new employees towards the minimum, around the minimum, sorry, your less experienced employees around the minimum. Your anyone where you've got doubt about performance, pay them around the minimum so that you don't pay a premium salary to someone who is not giving you value. Then as you come to the midpoint, people who must be paid around the midpoint, that's towards the midpoint, on the midpoint, or slightly above the midpoint, are really your top performers. Okay, these are your top performers. They must be paid around the midpoint. Those are the people who must then have a combo ratio of around 100, 99, 95, 105. Those are your top top performers. Then anyone who is paid around the maximum must be really be rare talent. It must never happen. It rarely happens for you to be able to pay anyone around the the maximum of a pay grade. So it means that person is really rare talent. That's the logic in the standard in pay structuring. Was the top year you are reserving for your top talent. But what you find in practice, if you do an audit of the pay structure, you may find that everyone is really on a combo ratio of 130, 150, 125, which is not ideal. Your combo ratio must give you a normal distribution when you look at the pay structure in your organization. Very crucial for you to understand that it's important to understand these techniques for managing pay structure. If you don't manage these things well, what tend to happen is that you go through episodes of job evaluation, because after 2 years or 3 years, your job evaluation has been bastardized, it's redundant, you want to bring another one. Instead of using the Castello, you go to the Patterson system, because people have no faith in the current job evaluation system. But the major culprit is how you manage the pay structure. If you manage it according to international standards that I'm giving you now, you'll never have a problem in terms. You can have your job evaluation system going for 20 years, even 30 years, even 40 years. Because there is no need for you to be able to constantly change the job grading system if you are managing the pay structure. Because once the pay structure is now indicating elements of inequity, people start complaining, people start bringing their jobs for reevaluation and things like that, because you are not managing the pay structure properly. What tend to happen as well is that, especially with senior managers and also in owner-managed organizations, find that someone comes into the organization, they're in grade 7, the CEO likes them, they move them to the maximum of the grade, 8, 5, 6, 6. But others on average are on the bottom, at the minimum of the grade. Or they come in and say, look, I don't know, they are too special. They must not be in grade 7. They must be in grade 6. They get paid 11,000, which is the maximum of the grade, the next grade, which is grade 6. All these are things that can really make your pay structure redundant and very much inequitable when you look at it from the employee's point. So that's the comparison. The combo ratio can also be used when you are looking at the market. For example, if someone has done a salary survey for you, they can actually calculate combo ratios by just saying your own salary versus the 25th percentile, your own salary versus the 50th percentile, your own salary versus the 70th. So a combo ratio in the salary survey can be calculated for any of the anchor points, which is the 25th percentile, the lower quarter, the 50th percentile, which is the median, or the 75th percentile, which is the upper quarter, or the 90th percentile, which is the upper decile. All those can be used as anchor points. They're just trying to show globally how far are you from the target market point, the target market position, or those anchor market positions. So that's how you use the combo ratio, a very important control point in an organization. Then you come here, what is called the pay range penetration. Range penetration, you are saying, if you look at the range of salary, how far someone has moved within that range. Okay, for example, you can automatically see that the people in yellow, they're indicating a range penetration of minus, but they are not even in the range. Okay, so these are things that you must reflect and address. Then you go to a person like Cheryl, who is the machine operator, 200% range. So they actually double the range. What they're earning, they're really earning above the maximum of that particular grade. These are all issues to flag and look at. If you've got 1,000 employees, they may not be apparent just by looking at a few individuals. So you need someone who can do these calculations for you. That's how you use the comparison. Then there's one thing that I also want to talk about, which is very common, which is called, you must avoid what is called pay compression. Pay compression happens when a situation when there's very little differentiation in salary. For example, I want to come here and say, let's say someone is in grade 7 there, okay? If your ranges are too narrow, you may find that people are earning the same salary up to the last dollar. That is also pay compression. The other situation is where you have grade creep, where you have people in the lower grade earning far much higher. Normally, the alarm is triggered when people in the lower grade are earning close to the midpoint of the next grade. That is normally should never happen, okay, even if there are overlaps. So once that starts happening, there's a problem. What can bring that kind of situation, especially in our situation in this country, is that you find that lower level employees, because they go for collective bargaining, they get higher increases, 200 to 100%, 80%, managers get 20%. So with time, you find that the managers are slowly earning less and less. and the gap between the managers and the employees is actually closing. That can bring what is called pay compression. Pay compression tend to bring elements of inequity. Eventually, you may have to change the grading system because people start complaining or they want their grade changed. So it's a major issue that you need to be aware of. Another important aspect in administering your pay structure is that when you are doing your salary increases, this is the way to avoid pay compression on all the issues that I have highlighted. The first thing is you must calculate the combat ratio of each individual versus your pay structure. Okay, so like you can see here, it's 80% to 120. You calculate that. Then your salary adjustment, let's say you've been given 50% to spend. The maximum that you can give is 50% for an individual. What you then do, you spread the salaries. You give people who are on a lower combat ratio more increase than people who are on a higher combat ratio. The logic is, the person who is already on 120% combat ratio is already earning enough. They're really earning very competitively. And if the pay structure is really aligned to the market, there is very little chance that they will leave. But the person who is in a lower combat ratio may leave because they are on a lower combat ratio. They are actually not yet earning a competitive salary. So this is another way of trying to move them towards a competitive remuneration. So once you do this, it's very unlikely that you have great creep. You have the normal pay compression where you've got very little differentiation in the organization. What you find in most organizations, which is really terrible, is that, let's take, for example, people in grade 16. So there is no mechanism for differentiating salaries within the organization. So people will come in, the minimum is 449. So everyone starts on 449. No, and every year, everyone gets the same percentage increase, 20%, 50%, 150, 200, whatever percentage increase that you're getting, whatever period. So what tend to happen is that you then get the people who have been in the organization for 10 years earning exactly 4449. People who came yesterday earning exactly 4449. If you are in such kind of a situation, you really don't know how to manage your pay structure. You as the HR manager, that should never happen in your organization, because we are assuming as well that the people who have been there, they've been kept there because they're adding value to their performance. So you may not compare them exactly as the new person who is joining the organization. You don't know how they're going to perform if they join. If they are really a good performer, they can progress within the pay range, as I have shown already. So that's important. If you are not giving a general pay increase like we talked about, you are giving a merit increase, you use this kind of table, which is called a merit table. You can see here, I've got the performance rating. It can be any performance rating. So in this case, the performance rating is ranging from 1 to 5, with 5 being the highest. Then your compa ratio is 80 to 120. So as you can see, it's a sliding scale. If someone is a top performer who is a 5 and they're on 80% combat ratio, they get the maximum increase. But if someone is a top performer and they're on 120% 120% combat ratio, they get 10. So this is how you equalize and make sure that there is equity within the organization. It's called a merit increase table. It's very easy to do in Excel. Once you automate it, it's very easy. You can run even for 20,000. Employees. That makes sure that your pay structure remains current. It's not going to be affected. The other way to look at it is this way. You've got a grade, your minimum, your midpoint, the maximum. This is already something that I have explained. So your minimum really depicts your new poor and poor performers who tend to, these are new employees and poor performers who earn around the midpoint. Then as you go to the midpoint, you are going to look at your top performers. Then your maximum, you're going to look at your exceptional performance. The other way to then look at this is to then, in Excel, you then constantly check this person that way. For example, if you look at grade 6, if this person is earning, let me maybe go to this one and look at one individual, Obet. Obet is earning a salary of for 5,000. Let me look at someone who is earning high, this one. Mine manager, Mangwe Magwembe. Okay, if you look at this, Magwembe earning a salary of 11,260. They're already earning at the midpoint. You need to constantly check what is their performance rating? Okay, does it justify them to earn at the midpoint? If not, you need to do something about it, because it will bring elements of inequity. People start complaining. How come someone is being paid competitively around the market control point when they are actually not adding as much value as the other employees? The other normal common issue that comes out all the time is the issue of notching. I don't recommend notching. It's a bad idea. It's a bad idea as long as you can use this kind of salary adjustment model. And this kind of salary adjustment model, you don't need the notching system. So the notching, what you're saying is you're subdividing your pay range into smaller percentages and call it notch one, notch two, whatever. So normally what happens in civil service across the globe is that you then find someone who has reached an anniversary. Every anniversary year, they're given a certain amount of notches. These are predetermined. It's really a cake and old-fashioned kind of adjusting salaries, and I don't recommend it. You may have your own ideas, but I don't recommend using notches. Where people look forward to getting notches, whether they add value or not, it's not good. If people are performing, use the merit table, which is this one. If you are giving an across-the-board increase, use this kind of table, not the notching. So now let's. I gave you that overview, and you now know what the pay structure is. We'll shortly go into a simple example of how to calculate how to do a pay structure. So the thing that you need to look at before you do a pay structure is basically you need to look at your economic factors, labor supply, market salary trends, management philosophy, social political environment, legal environment. As you can see, for example, in the legal environment, your pay structure for those that are NEC employees must never be below what the NEC is paying. So you must be able to align your pay structure so that your minimums are above what the NEC is paying. Short-term or short-term orientation, these are all factors you must look at them. At any given time, you may find, for example, if you look at labor supply, you may find that there are certain skills that are really in demand, that are fetching a premium on the market. There's no way of escaping that as an organization. How you can escape with various tactics that you can use. You may decide we're not going to up our basic salary. We may want to give them a car. We may want to give them some incentive, or you may want to use other means of attracting those employees. Economic factors, currently we're in almost hyperinflation, and it's affecting how people are remunerating. Others have gone to anchoring their salaries based on US dollar. Others are going to give groceries in kind. So many things that are happening. All these are factors that you need to take into consideration. You must also assess on your own what is the impact of each package. For example, if you look at the salary, the impact of the salary, this particular table comes from the World of Work booklet. So if you look at this, you find that a salary can help you recruit. If you're paying a top dollar, you recruit people, you retain them, but it doesn't necessarily motivate them. They are mercenaries that will join your organization to milk your organization and get in a good salary, but never give you value. So it must be very clear. A salary will help you retain. If you are paying a top dollar, you can attract anyone. If you are paying a top dollar, you can retain. People can remain within your organization, but they may not give you value. They may not even be motivated. But if you got incentives, for example, you find they recruit, they help you retain, they recruit and motivate. Benefits, they don't motivate. Just like a salary. People love cars. People love all those benefits, school fees, but they're never motivated with those. Intangibles, they don't help you recruit because people don't see them. They help you retain, definitely motivate the employees that you have. So these are all factors. So the pay orientation of your strategy is also very crucial. If you look at most situations, find people are on the traditional model, where you have a high basic salary, low incentives or which is both long-term and short-term, a guaranteed package, very high, non-monetary and high, and monetary, and the common that there is paternalistic kind of pay model. Then dynamic, you've got a low basic salary, you will have incentives, both long-term and short-term. Guaranteed pay, no guaranteed pay, low guaranteed pay in both monetary and non-monetary. This is basically based on the value-sharing model. Then the middle of the road is moderate across. In the common that there is undefined, it's really flexible. So you can decide, but you must always try, by all means. I know it's very difficult because as HR people, we also have a personal interest in this thing. Yeah. So what you find is that people are stuck with the traditional model. They want the company car, they want school fees, they want all these things that are there. But you look at long term and say, is it giving us value as an organization? So when you look at our situation here in Zimbabwe, for example, you will notice that 98% of the salary is guaranteed. In some cases, actually 99% is guaranteed. What it means is that whether the person delivers value or not, they get paid. Their salary comes. Whether they're at home or not, their salary comes. Is it a good model? This is for us to debate as HR professionals and probably rethink this model as a way of remunerating people in this country. Okay. What is the philosophy with regard to market positioning for your pay? I have already highlighted this. Are you going to target the 25th percentile, the median, or the upper quarter? The median is just the middle of the road, okay, which is your 50th percentile. Half. We are not paying very well. We are not underpaying very well, but we are in the middle of the road. But as you go to the upper quarter, as they're saying, we are in the top 25% of the top players in the country. This could be in your industry. This could be in the whole country, depending on the type of sample you are using. This could be across all industries. And also, as you're looking at that particular element in terms of your target market position, be extremely careful how you choose your target market position. Because if you're in manufacturing, it doesn't necessarily mean that you lose people to manufacturing entities alone. So you may also need to look at the general market. If you're in the banking sector, it doesn't necessarily follow that you're going to lose people in the banking sector. Some may go into insurance, some may go into there are certain positions that have not defined the market. HR is an example. Accounting. Most of the support functions have not defined the market. They can go and work anywhere. So if you're going to compare them specifically for your own sector, it may actually be misleading. You may actually need to look at other sectors as well. That's why it's important to not only look at we want the salary survey, specifically for our industry. Yes, it's good, but you must also then say, what is the general market paying for this particular position? The reason why most people are tempted to go to really focus on their own market is that, remember, salaries determine how you price your products. So if you pay your people too much versus your competitors, it means you have to find a way of recovering that cost somehow. Anything that you pay your staff, remember, it reduces profit. The point that you need to understand. Anything that you pay as a staff cost reduces your profit. And by reducing profits, you are also reducing shareholder value. And that must be at the bottom of your mind as you go through this kind of analysis. Others on total cost to company model. Remember, a pay structure is designed normally for the basic salary. But if you're on total cost, you can also design your pay structure to reflect that you are on total cost. But more importantly, once your grades, for example, once these grades are out, you can then also come up with what's called a benefit structure for yourself. Say, those in grade one get a car, this type of car, leave, medical aid, and all the other benefits associated with that grade. You can also come up with a table more or less like this for the benefits alone, over and above this particular pay structure, the table that I've shown you there. Okay, we have talked about that. What is also important is you are designing your remuneration model and pay structure is looking at your age profile. If you are really employing the millennials, you may not want to put more emphasis on pension. These guys would want cars, they don't care about school fees unless it's school fees for themselves. Most of them are not married. They're really wanting to show off. So what are the things that we can give them in order to attract them? Okay, the laptop, a car is normally a thing. You may even look at a house for them, things like that. Housing loans, so that they own a house early in their lifetime. That's another way of retaining those people. We have already talked about that. Before I go into an example of how to structure pay, a simple example, then we then talk to look at questions. You need to understand some of the things that are the simple statistics that is used in pay structuring. Average, I'm sure you know, the sum divided by the number of participants or whatever, the most frequent number, the median, the value, that is half the data that that you have ranked in from low to, from high to low, that is your median. So it's important to look at that. So, but what is crucial? It's not really the definition. What is crucial is what are the characteristics of the mean. If you look at the mean, it uses all data points, and consequently, the mean is affected by outliers. For example, if there's a higher figure, the mean tends to take that into consideration. If there's an extreme lower figure, the mean takes that into consideration. Let me give you an example. Let's take, for example, you want to cross Lake Kariba, and you are told the average depth of Lake Kariba is a half a meter. Will you cross Lake Kariba? Okay? It's misleading because if you go into that, yes, the average is that, but the depth could be, in some cases, 20 meters, and you're going to drown if you don't know how to swim. So those are all elements that you must look at when you look at the the average. The median, it includes the influence of all extreme values, so it's not affected by extreme values, the median. That's why it's more preferred than the mean. Percentiles, a percentile is a given percentage of data in less than or equal to, e.g. 90% is the value of 90% of the data are less or equal to. So if you're looking at percentiles, the best way to interpret it is that if you're at the 50th percentile, if you're paying someone at the 50th percentile, it means that you are paying better than 50% of the market or whatever market you are targeting. If you are at 90th percentile, you are paying better than 90% of the market. That's the easiest way, especially in relation to remuneration. Okay. We talked about using percentiles for anchoring your competitive position. That is done. Interquartile, we talked about that. The interquartile range is the difference between the 25th and 75th percentile, if you just want to find what the interquartile is. Okay, measures of variability, that's your mean, your percentiles, all these are measures of variability, but I'm not going to waste a lot of time there. One important aspect to take note is when you are looking at the salary survey data, normally they're based on a sample, and these are not random samples. They're mainly convenient samples, because you have to call people. Some may want to play to participate, some don't want to participate, so you can't call it a random sample. So the outcome is not really a random. If you've got a population, it means all the participants are represented. It's not a sample. I'm not going to that. Standard deviation, important to note, but I don't want to confuse you. Some are scared of maths. That's an average deviation or distance of all data points from the mean. That's really the standard deviation. The larger the standard deviation, the more spread out the data point. For those that are more sophisticated, instead of using the compa ratio, the range penetration, you can use the standard deviation, and even to some extent your Z-score to see how the salaries are distributed and where you should pay attention. Coefficient of variation is the measure of relative variation of the data values about the mean in terms of percent. That is, so what you're doing there is your standard deviation divided by the mean times 100. But I won't bother you with that. Okay, the range we've already talked. So let's build a pay structure model here. I'll show you. So the first thing that you need to understand, I'll share this screen. Just give me a minute. Okay, this one. I hope you can see this on the screen, this particular. So what you do is, you after job grading, you take all your grades. Here I've just picked a few. So you go into the market, look at what the market is paying. What are we targeting? For example, this company is targeting the median. So you look at the median there. Okay, you put for each grade. So you're looking at the average median salary for all the jobs in that particular grade. So you put all of them there. As you can see, so that's basically a reflection by grades instead of going by. If we had all the data points, we can still do it using all the data points. But here I've just taken a shortcut and say these are our grades: grade 1 to 16. In this case, 16 is the highest, but it can also be the best. In past Castellion, remember, 1 is the highest grade. That's where you normally find your CEOs and other senior roles. But this one I've reversed it. So what you see is that. We've got a grade there, we've got a median. This could be the 75th percentile, this could be 50th percentile, depending on your anchor point, your target market position. So in this case, this organization is targeting the median. So once that is done, the first thing that you need to do is to look at the distribution of that data. So you go to insert, you go here, and you look at the scatter. Okay, so you can already see there, the grades, they go up to 16, you can change that and limit the maximum to 16 because the grades go up to 16. So this is how you can see this is approximating a linear kind of distribution. So what you then do is you go there and say add trend line to that. So you go there and put a display equation on the chart. Okay, so you display your equation. You can see the equation there. Let me go there and try to enlarge that so that you see that's our equation. Okay, so the equation we're trying to predict. What will be the reason why we're trying to have this trend line is to get the midpoint for our pay structure. Okay, some can use this direct as it is, but it's not ideal. It's better to actually get the midpoint of that distribution to get your midpoint. So what I need now to do, I come to here and say equals to, and I now need to calculate the midpoint, isn't it? So I know my coefficient is 13.46, which is there. And my intercept is 282.86. So I will say that times the grade, because remember we're trying to calculate the midpoint for a grade, okay? Plus 286, which is our constant, okay? Then I just say that, no, sorry. So what I come here, I want to fix, that with a dollar, I want to fix that so that it doesn't change there. Then here, I also come and fix that Okay. Then after that, I put like this. So I've already, this is be my pay spine. So if you come here, but you can see it's inconsistent, we'll deal with that at the end. This is the progression. You can see it's actually inconsistent across across grades. So that's our midpoint. Then to calculate your minimum, the formula is very easy. Then we just say equals your midpoint divided by the mean factor there. Oh, sorry. That's your midpoint divided by the mean factor there. Okay, I again fix this B. Okay, I've already done there. Okay, the maximum is already there, but the maximum, the way to calculate the maximum is your mean times the max range, this one. Okay, then I fix this so that it doesn't change, so that we get the correct answer. Okay. Already you can see, so if I come here to look at my pay structure, I can hide my median, the market data there, and remain just with that. This is exactly the table that I was showing in there. Sorry. I've already produced my pay structure in a very simple way. That becomes my pay structure. But you can see here we've got a problem of the midpoint that is inconsistent. You can see the lower grades have got a higher progression than the higher grades. So what you can do is you can go back. There are various ways of looking at calculating this midpoint. We know the midpoint should be ideal, should be around 30% to about 80% or 60%. So I want to use a midpoint, a range of a midpoint of 80%. Okay. So what do I do? I come here, the bottom salary, and multiply this. I'll say multiply by 1. No, not the bottom, sorry, this one. And multiply by 1.30. No? Okay, let me copy this. I'll copy this and remove the formulas so that it's not complicated. So I'll come here, copy, paste. Okay, let me come back, copy, paste special, and I want to just put values, okay, on the midpoint. So that's it. So what I do is I come here and say equals this times 1.30 to equalize the midpoint. Then I copy this upwards. Okay, now I've got a proper pay structure with a smooth progression. But this can be, there are various ways statistically of smoothening this curve, this particular progression. But I don't want to go in there, that's more complicated. So already after this, you've got a pay structure, you've done your grading, you've got a pay structure, your pay structure is intact. What is left is then to copy your pay structure into any other document that you want. That's basically how you do a pay structure. If you want, your data may not actually reflect a linear. It may actually be showing some form of exponential distribution. Again, you can also use other methods to do that. So that's what you do. Your pay structure. We covered all that. Let me see if there's anything else that I have left out. We covered the ranges. Maintaining the pay structure. Range penetration, we talked about that. What is also crucial is that I remember when I was working for BHP some years back, the pay structure was not a secret. It was actually displayed on the notice board. But most people, they don't want to share their pay structure for various reasons. If you share your pay structure, depending on your culture in the organization, it may actually help you to all areas of inequity that may be in your organization. So if you don't want to share the full pay structure, because we now with social media, people will then share it on the social media. You may want to let each employee know what is the minimum for their grade, what is the midpoint, what is the maximum, and how can they earn more within that particular grade. For example, through performing, when you do adjustment, you use you do that and factor in the issue of performance. Okay, this we all covered. Okay, I now want to take questions. If you've got any questions, you can ask me questions. Unmute yourself and ask me questions. Questions. Just unmute yourself and ask me questions before we close the session.
Morning, sir.
Morning, yes. How are you?
Well, thanks. For us that are covered by the NEC, so now what has happened now is that monthly the cost of living allowance has been reviewed, but the basic wage has not. So the hourly rates have stayed fairly stable. How would you then comfortably work out what your minimum should be and your median so that then progression can be controlled?
Okay, what you do is that regardless whether the NEC has got minimums or not, you must have what you consider to be a competitive pay structure for your employees internally, which you design internally. That's why even companies that have got NEC, minimums, they still have their own internal minimums. So you must have what you say. Okay. For example, let's take an example. You may have someone who is an artisan assistant, as an example. And that person is in Patterson grade 14. The NEC may be paying that person a minimum of 2,000. But internally, you may actually have your minimum of 2.5, which means you're actually going to pay them 2.5. You are still complying with the NEC, and you're still paying those other variable NEC payments that are paid every month. But you are not lagging behind in terms of your pay structure. The danger with leaving your pay structure to lag behind is it will be very costly for you in future when you want to adjust, because the gap will be much wider. So my recommendation is that despite what is happening on the NEC, you must still have your own competitive pay structure covering everyone internally, which must always comply with NEC minimums, which means that you don't pay below the NEC minimum.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Okay. Any other question? I know people have good questions on this one. Questions. If you don't want to ask the question directly, you can put on the chat there. I will answer the question for you. Feel free to put the question on the chat from there. Okay, it seems there are no questions. So I would like to thank you very much for attending this particular session. As you can see, I didn't really go into the technical aspects of the pay structure where there are so many formulas, the distribution and things like that. We can do that once we get enough traction in terms of people understanding the basics. So this one will be repeated. Remember also this session has been recorded. We'll share the link to the recording later today or tomorrow morning. You can keep on going back to it and get a fair understanding before you go into the technical aspect of pay structuring. Otherwise, thank you very much. Thank you very much. I think that's the end of our session today. We meet again in the next session. The next session is on the 12th, where we are discussing with the gentleman from Australia. We're looking at productivity, and that gentleman will also be covering productivity linked wages. He's an expert. He has been in South Africa. He's now in Australia. He's doing a lot of work for mines and other big organizations in Australia. Don't miss that one if you want to understand anything to do with the productivity linked wages. There's a link on our app where you can actually register. Otherwise, thank you very much. Enjoy your day.